just write to can be found on page 355 of the red prayer book in the pews. Page 355. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, whom truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for a word from Holy Scripture.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now, the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So, when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them?" Then Peter began to explain it to them, step by step, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' But I replied, 'By no means, Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' But a second time, the voice answered from heaven, 'What God has made clean, you must not call profane.' This happened three times. Then everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very moment, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing at his house and saying, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved." And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God? When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Revelation to John. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them, they will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
At the Last Supper, when Judas had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Aunt Bliss, my father's oldest sister, somewhat late in life, turned the garage into a woman's clothing shop. And the merchandise began to ooze into the dining room. And then she was so successful and having so much fun that the living room became a bridal shop. One day while visiting her, probably about age 4, clearly not being a very tactful child, I stated that I thought it was quite silly to spend all that money on a dress that could only be worn for part of one day. I further sat in the middle of that bridal shop and said that I thought it was rather ridiculous for a man on the most important day of his life to be in a rented suit. And my aunt patiently explained that when I was older, I would feel differently. I didn't. Brides do spend a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of energy getting ready for the wedding day. It was revealed to John on the Isle of Patmos, where he was exiled, that the new Jerusalem would come down out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. The holy city will be washed, dressed, readied for the bridegroom, Christ. One does not put on the wedding gown or the tuxedo without first bathing. And the new Jerusalem will be washed clean of greed, corruption, injustice, cleansed of mourning, crying, pain, death, and thus tears. John is told to write these trustworthy and true words. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those words, it is done, echo words said by Jesus on the cross. It is finished. Finished. Done. The goal met. The victory won. Those are Easter words. Through the bridegroom's self-giving obedience, all is coming to fruition. In our reading from the Acts of the Apostles, Peter's vision of the sailcloth holding the creatures treated as unclean is meant to communicate that no people or group is to be shunned as unworthy of God's new Jerusalem. We are not to declare unclean, profane, that which God has been declared clean. The Holy Spirit is given to the Jew and the Gentile, and that means the Spirit is given to all peoples. We must not hinder those whom God invites into his holy city. How often have we hindered God's work rather than assisted it? How often do we scatter sheep rather than gather them into the flock? These are questions that we need to consider periodically. When a great European cathedral caught fire during Holy Week, within a couple of hours, I heard two people declare that the fire was probably set by Muslims. Such responses and words do hinder the work of God's reconciliation. Peter's vision is about the mission of the church, the mission Jesus set in place. Our call is to continue Jesus' work of reconciling humanity with God and with one another. The church is to be a missionary body. If church stays centered on whose we are and on the good news of Jesus Christ and the resurrection, then it will be mission-minded. Remember Paul's doxology. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. It's not by accident that those words are offered in the Book of Common Prayer as one of the ways to end the office of morning prayer, the way that we are to start every day. There are many wonderful organizations that exist to do good work in the world, but the church is specifically called to make God and His kingdom known. Good works are one way that we do that. But we do so focused on the fact that we are the agent of God, who is the true source of all help and all good works. We can do good works in a way that puts the focus on us rather than on God. They are about church maintenance and about church survival, not about mission, not about God's grace in the world. The tempter offered Jesus worthy powers, such as turning stones into bread. I mean, right there, the end to world hunger. But they had nothing to do with God. Those powers were to move the world away from God. Strong on works while weak on thanksgiving is not mission-minded life and ministry. Strong on programs while lacking celebration, praise, and worship, the praise that the psalm today calls us to, is not the ministry of mission. Being focused on fixing people's problems without first examining them in the light of Scripture and Christ, without discerning where God is to be found in them, is not mission. It's not the breaking open of God's kingdom in the world. Might we dare to ask this question? If Emmanuel, and I'm not just talking about the building, I'm talking about the body of Christ here. If Emmanuel fell into a deep sinkhole here this morning and turned to dust, would the people of Rapid City or the people of the Diocese of South Dakota, what would they think was lost? What would we be remembered for? Would our disappearance be noticed? Would the work of God be lessened in Rapid City because of our absence? Would prior signs of faith and of hope be missing? Would the very presence of Christ and his love experienced here in the celebrations of Holy Eucharist at this altar be lamented by anyone? Questions to ponder. Episcopalians have long joked about the E word. It's time we stop joking about the E word. For any here this morning who aren't Episcopalians or don't know what the E word is, stands for evangelization. It's our code. We don't even like to say the word. We need to say the word. Evangelization, it's not something to be avoided. The fact that some churches have done it very poorly should not be our stumbling block. It's not about shouting Bible verses in people's faces. It's not about running up to people and asking, "Are you saved?" It's about celebrating God's work in our lives. Here's a good definition of evangelism. Evangelism is the ministry of introducing God in the world to the world, and it rejoices in using everyday stories and events. I'm going to repeat that. Evangelization, or evangelism, is the ministry of introducing God in the world to the world, and it rejoices in using everyday stories and events. Evangelism done well will bring changes to a community. And we know that change can be a bit unsettling, but it's part of our life in Christ. I want to give you an example of good evangelism, and it comes from the life of this congregation. Recently, with trepidation, I asked the Episcopal church women, and I was asking at a time when they already had a full plate, They had another funeral luncheon they were working on. They had the spring luncheon coming up. And they had the dinner for the bishop candidates' walkabout to put on. And I asked them if they would do a funeral luncheon for a family that wasn't even a member of this parish. And immediately they answered me, "Certainly we will." And they did it magnificently. They cut no corners. A family member excitedly told me that there had been a miracle at the luncheon. That's her word, not mine. A miracle at the luncheon. She explained that two family members had come to the funeral. They had been estranged from each other, hadn't spoken in years. So everybody expected, well, first of all, they were surprised they both came, but then they expected they'd sit far apart from each other in the service and kind of pretend the other one wasn't here. Well, guess what? By the grace of God, they sat down at the same table at the luncheon. And they talked, and they laughed, and they ate together. The ECW, doing evangelism at its best, provided the opportunity for God to do his reconciling, healing work. Could God have done it another way? Of course. But God chose to work through our ECW, through their yes. Such things happen all the time in our community, but we fail to share the stories and to celebrate the love and grace of God that we see happening all around us. There's not one person in this room, not one, that does not carry the experience of seeing God's hand at work in the world. You know that's true. There's not one of you. Share those stories with one another. Share them with your friends. And share them with strangers. Don't keep the stories to yourself. Because to hold them untold is to hide God. It's to put Jesus, the life and light of the world, under a bushel basket. Sisters and brothers, the Lord is risen. And the Lord seeks to continue his work of mission through us and with us. Out of all of creation, God chose human beings, gave them the ability to reason, and gave them language to know and to share and praise the Lord. So let us dedicate our lives to that. Tell out the good news of Jesus' resurrection and of his presence. Alleluia, alleluia. Having heard the word of God, let us stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the baptismal covenant found on page 304. Page 304 of the prayer book. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator.
you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil? And whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people, and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
As we pray for Christ Church in the world, we'll use Form 6 of the Prayers of the People, found on page 392. Page 392 of the Prayer Book.
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work.
Friends and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For our presiding bishop, our bishops, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God and His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome especially to any visitors and guests who may be with us this morning. Today is a great day of joy and celebration. Today is the one-year anniversary of Mother Virginia Byrd's ordination to the priesthood of Jesus Christ. So on such occasions, priests work harder and more. So I said she had to preside and preach today at both services. So I've just kind of been hanging out. But Mother Virginia, we have been on a spiritual journey together now for 6 years, you and I. And you have been part of the Rapid City community for much, much longer than that, having served our church as a vocational deacon for 30 years and now as a priest of Jesus Christ for 1 year. I can assure you that if there was a sinkhole and we were all swallowed up, your absence would be greatly felt. You are an incredible priest, an incredible friend and mentor, and the way in which you have honored the call of God to serve as a priest, and the way in which you have spread the gospel and evangelized on our behalf by going into the nursing home communities of Rapid City to bring the Eucharist, and not just to deliver it, but to actually celebrate the Eucharist there. I know that that was a specific part of the call that you felt to the priesthood. And I cannot thank you enough as the rector and as your friend. We owe you so much honor and gratitude. So thank you and congratulations on your 1 year anniversary. I would like to thank all of you for your generosity and the speed with which you met the goal of raising $2,500 for the Hope Center. We have achieved our goal, but we are still accepting donations for the Hope Center. Just because we met the goal doesn't mean that we have to stop, but we still continue to take a collection. We will let you know later on when that week will be, that it'll be Emmanuel's week, where the Hope Center's administrative costs will be covered. So thank you so much for your generosity and your continued evangelization. Next Sunday is Memorial Day weekend, and the Cornerstone Rescue Mission meal, it's our Sunday, and our core team, several of those core team members will be out of town because of the Memorial Day holiday. We could use some extra hands and some help. Mara Vakurovich is going to be the team leader for the meal. And so if you could sign up outside by where we sell the gift cards, the food certificates for the church response, it would be a great blessing if we could go into the week knowing who is committed to be there. We know a lot of people travel on Memorial Day, and so we want to make sure that we have all of our bases covered. So please sign up or chat with Mara about your availability next week. Also in your bulletin, you'll see that Dr. Chris Corbin, who works for the Bishop's Office here in the Diocese of South Dakota, will be here Wednesday night for, believe it or not, Mother Virginia, an evangelism workshop. This is a program that he's done throughout the diocese. Wednesday night will be the final installment of that. He's brought it to various parishes, and so he'll be concluding here at Emmanuel. It's the same program everywhere he's been, but we are going to videotape it, hopefully put it online if you're not able to make it. But it would be a great showing if Emmanuel could turn out and support Dr. Corbin and the great message that he has. It'll be again at about 5:30, I believe, so bring your sack dinners with you. Feel free, we'll have the table set up so that you can eat and learn all at the same time. Finally, the final announcement that I have for you is that I am filled with lots of different emotions this morning, a little nervousness and sadness, but also joy and excitement. I have been called and have accepted the call to serve as the rector of St. John's Episcopal Church in Lynchburg, Virginia. It's been a period of discernment for my family and I. We have seen our parents, Allison and I have seen our parents get older. I have a sister at home who needs extra special care. I've seen my brother's children and Allison's brother's children grow up, and we're just not physically, geographically close. And so we wanted to get closer to home, be closer to our families, and an opportunity arose, and so we feel that the Holy Spirit has spoken. We feel so blessed to have been with you for 6 years. We will be here for another month and a half or so. We will conclude our ministry here at the end of June and begin in Lynchburg, Virginia, at the beginning of July. And so I thank you for the trust that you have placed in me as your priest and in us. I thank you for the way in which you have welcomed my family and welcomed us. This was not an easy decision. It was filled with lots of prayer. And as we go forward, know that our hearts are a bit broken and we will grieve. But we know that God is in all things. God will provide for Emmanuel. God has provided for you for 131 years, and God is still here. That's what Emmanuel means, God with us. Dr. Corbin met with the vestry earlier this week and has laid out the transition process. There will be an interim rector who will come and serve after my departure and before the hire of your next rector. That process will include a search committee and will include developing a parish profile and doing a nationwide search to find the next priest of Jesus Christ. And whoever that person is, I know that they will be as privileged and honored to serve you as I have been. They will be blessed beyond measure. And so we will do everything we can, and I'll do everything I can to advocate for you to make sure that your next priest is a fantastic blessing unto you. So I'm just rambling now because I don't know what else to say, and I'm nervous and I'm filled with emotion, so I guess I'll shut up now. Don't you love when people say they'll stop talking, they keep talking? So I'll stop. Thank you so much. Know that my family and I love you dearly. God bless you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
When shall I saw?
receive these back. Is there anyone who desires an anointing this morning for birthday, travel, anniversary? Lord Jesus Christ, you are the great healer. You heal us in body and mind and spirit. Your daughter comes before you waiting test results, seeking good news. And you certainly are the God of good news. Be with her. Let her feel your peace and your comfort and your presence. And may the news that she receives strengthen her and nourish her for further work in your mission. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are blessed. Who's getting older? Tyson's getting older. Which birthday, Tyson?
May 22nd.
And how old are you going to be?
Six.
Wow. He's really getting to be a big old brother, isn't he? Huh? Yeah. Well, let's pray for Tyson. The birthday prayer is in the bulletin.
Watch over thy child, O Lord, as his days increase. Bless and guide him wherever he may be. Strengthen him when he stands. Comfort him when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise him up if he falls. And in his heart, may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of his life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And when's your birthday?
November 20th.
Okay, we will await that date. Okay? Well, not as long as you think, Tyson. Oh. Our celebration of Holy Eucharist continues on page 372 of the prayer book. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks. For you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and fill them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. And beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing.
Thank you.
acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you love the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death, and made the whole creation new. That we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment and the sanctification and all of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you. Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people. The bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share in this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, you are one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. Remember Michael, John, Jonathan, and all who minister in your church. Remember all your people and those who seek your truth. Remember those that we now hold before you silently or aloud. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to you alone, and bring them into the place of eternal joy and light. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Are welcome to receive the body and blood of Christ.
366 of the prayer book. 366. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, set us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May God, who brought us out of bondage to sin into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to your eternal inheritance. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of the risen Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.